sweet love lay on the ground. Lay your love on the track. We're gonna break the monster's back.
You think you've got the stuff. You're telling me and anyone you're hard enough.
Sometimes You Can't Make It On Your Own is quite a different song in that it was a kind of quite a traditional rock and roll chord sequence, just the which is, that was the problem in some ways. It was too traditional. It was like Stand By Me or something. You know, it had all of those qualities. And then the first rewrite, I tried with augmented chords to take it somewhere else. So it's tough, you think you've got the stuff. You're telling me and anyone you're hard enough. And that, actually, we're excited about that. We thought that was different. But again, in the end, it just didn't feel like that's what the melody needed. And then actually Bono suggested a different approach, and we ended up with, I can't remember, like,
Time, you think you've got the stuff. You're telling me and anyone you're hard enough. You don't have to put up a fight. You don't have to always be right. Let me take some of the punches for you tonight.
Took 3 years waiting on that song, and then a couple of weeks ago it just came together, and it feels like the song always existed.
They played me this track and I listened to it and I thought, wow, that's a great song. It doesn't have a chorus. And Bonnie said, what do you mean? I said, well, look, the line that goes, sometimes you can make it on your own, just before that there's nothing there. It's like that line is the payoff of what a chorus is. So Bono says, Edge, give me a guitar. And he wrote it like in 2 seconds. You figure that the falsetto section.
And it's you and I look in the mirror. And it's you and I don't pick up the phone. Sometimes you can't make it on your own.
You know, apart from the little falsetto line, that song has been around for a few years. Even before my father died, that song was around. And it was written about him even then. It was just waiting there.
Listen to me now. You don't have to go in alone.
you know, it's a song that Bono wrote the lyric, you know, when his father was, when it was obvious that his father was going to die from cancer, when we were recording the last record. And fortunately, Bob actually kind of lived for quite a long time and lived through to the tour, and Bono was able to kind of spend a lot of time with him on the tour, and then eventually passed away, as people probably know, before our Slane gig. So, you know, it's an important song from that point of view for him. You know, it documents a very real moment for him and continuing moment. So it's going to be interesting to see how that one performs live.
Try crumbs. Oh, crumbs. It's a beautiful part.
I have absolutely no memory of Crumbs from the Table. I can't remember a damn thing about it. I really can't.
There's only one song in all our lives that we ever wrote,
Drinking.
And that happens to be on this record, which is Crumbs on Your Table.
Now, we replayed it. I replayed it a few times, but I can't remember the history of the song. I can't remember where it came from.
It was very late, sun was coming up. And I'm not a late night person. I much rather get up early in the morning, but Edge is like, he's an owl. So he would just sit there, you know, and days could go by and he wouldn't need sleep. He ended up getting the guitar and singing. And it was one of those moments where two mates are not talking sense, but they're doing it at the same time. And then eventually it sort of coagulates into a thought, and in this case, a melody and a chord sequence. The song, the Crumbs from the Table, title, everything, words, boom, all arrived.
From the brightest star comes the blackest hole. You've so much to offer. What did you offer your soul? I was there for you, baby. Would you deny for others? Would you demand for yourself? Cool now, slow down. Come on. Come on, slow down. Come on. You speak signs and wonders, but I need something other. I would believe.
I have to find out about
crumbs.
Crumbs, yeah. It's very worrying.
It seems like it takes a very long time for everyone to commit, and it can only get finished or function if everyone has committed. So, you know, Larry can't commit to a drum part unless he has some idea of what the vocal is going to be and what the lyric is going to be. Bono doesn't want to commit to what that's going to be until he feels the music is kind of a bit more developed and there's plenty of kind of melodic counter melodies and what have you going on. So it's kind of everything kind of moving around itself for quite a long time. And then, you know, a little bit like musical chairs, everyone has to kind of commit and sit on something.
The studio is a very important player in the process. It decides whether a great song becomes a great record. So you want to have great people in the studio working with you, people who see that as their instrument. So we have a Flood and Gareth and Steve Lillywhite, who's been with us since we were a baby band. You know, we've got some amazing people on team. Nellie Hooper's been in doing some work. I mean, these are people who are creative with the studio as an instrument.
To go full circle is part of the process. Just completely changing the way the whole song is in order for maybe to find out that where you started at the beginning was the best place for it. It's almost like chop its head off and see if it still comes back fighting fit.
And then Bono and Edge become more of the critiques of us as we're moulding the sounds together and everything. So it's quite a fluid thing.
As producers, you're there to aid, abet, help, push, maybe shove in certain cases. But ultimately, it's the band who drives everything.
I was born a child of grace. Little else about the place.
An instrumental version of a song can be quite monotone and, you know, it's kind of linear. Everything changes when the vocal goes on. And what we try and do is record with the vocal, scat vocal or whatever, just to try and get the ebb and flow of a song, to give it some dynamic.
I like the sound.
When I write, it's there. There's no staring at a blank page. With you two, it's sort of songwriting by accident, really. I mean, we don't really know what we're doing, and when we do, it doesn't seem to help.
We try to stop Bono playing guitar. Unfortunately, some of it does seep through the grooves.
Depending on what you're trying to do, you would pick up a different instrument to work with. I mean, if I'm writing a rock and roll song, it has to be a guitar, you know, because rock and roll is about the guitar. It's about guitar riffs. It's about that kind of energy that you get from hitting the big E chord, you know, when you've got the amp turned up full, and there's no way you can get to that kind of feeling with another instrument. You know, I go somewhere completely different when I'm working on a piano to when I'm working on a guitar.
And that's not always a given, that he would want to play guitar. You know, he might be into keyboards this album. You know, you have Larry and Adam going, oh, he's into the keyboards now. We'll never get a rock song out of him.
Unos, dos, tres, catorce.
This is actually our first album. It's taken us 20 years or whatever it is. But this is our first album. And Vertigo is the first single from our first album. And oddly enough, in that spirit, there's a quote from our very first single. We had three songs on our first single. We were like 17, 18 years old. Out of Control, Boy, Girl, and a song called Stories for Boys. And in Stories for Boys, there's this Vertigo-like line for the Trainspotters.
The night is full. Holes as bullets rip the sky of ink with gold. They sparkle as the boys, they rock and roll. They know that they can dance, at least they know. I can stand the beats, masking for the check. Girl with crimson nails, Jesus round the neck. Swing into the music, swing into the music. Oh.
It's unusual for us, but the song remained the same for a long period of time without a lot of change. And it was only when Steve Lillywhite came in that we really knew what it was that we wanted from the song. What it really needed was the song to be deconstructed and sort of put back together again.
this could be yours. All of this, all of this could be yours. All of this could be yours. Just give me what I want, no one gets hurt, right?
Edge is not, you know, not the most rock and roll soul you could meet. He's a much more monkish, zen-like being. And by rock and roll, I mean metallic, blood running through your veins, kind of adrenalized music. He had been demoing some guitar parts. He played me this riff in Los Angeles.
It's kind of an eternal riff. It's like a riff that you think has always been there. You know, it's like, I suppose they're like melodies, you know? A great melody just is, you know? You don't, once you've heard it once, it's just kind of in the back of your mind. And I think guitar riffs can be like that.
Quite often those songs don't survive. There's a lot of a kind of anti-rock sentiment in the camp sometimes, but you know, that this time around, Edge kind of had a kind of free rein to really kind of work those rock tunes up.
Can a song make a difference? Songs can change the world. I mean, certainly my world. I mean, a song can change your mood, the temperature of the room you're in. Songs are incredible, because not like movies where you see them once or twice, three times. They become part of your life. It's like, they're more like smells. Songs, there's a few bad smells out there of ours, but when we get it right, there's a scent, freedom. Has a scent, and it's like the top of a newborn baby's head. Yeah, 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 yeah.